So I thought I would do one other example of sort of thinking about how energy moves around in a system. And in order to do that, I'm going to think about a system that you came to know and hate during the second diagnostic. So we're going to think about a rocket that's sitting on the surface of the Earth. The rocket has some amount of fuel inside it. During the time that the rocket is lifting off of the air, that fuel is going to get converted into exhaust. But in order to think about how I'm keep track of energy in this system, what I actually need to do is think about all the different places that energy could be stored and where I'm going to draw my system boundaries. And here's what I'm going to propose for my system boundaries. I'm going to include in my system all of the fuel of the rocket, including all that fuel that gets turned into exhaust. And then I'm also going to include the fact that there's a gravitational interaction between all the particles that are inside the rocket and the center of the Earth, right? So this is the gravitational interaction. And I'm going to also account for the energy that's stored in that gravitational interaction. Right? So as I sort of try to do my energy accounting, I'm going to be thinking about energy that was originally stored chemically, getting transformed either into kinetic energy stored in the motion of the rocket and the motion of the exhaust, or into potential energy that's stored in the interactions between all the particles in the system and the Earth. Okay. So, my cat seems to be... So anyways, let's think about some keyframes here. First keyframe, rocket sitting on the ground. Right? Second keyframe, the rocket is lifted off into the air, and so at this point there's some exhaust that's traveling down, the rocket is traveling up, right? And then the final keyframe, the rocket's run out of fuel, and because we didn't have enough fuel to get into orbit, and we didn't actually design the orbital trajectory right, the rocket's falling back down, right? So let's think about energy flows for this. Well, obviously one place we can store energy is in the chemical energy of the fuel. That chemical energy of the fuel, when the fuel burns, what it's doing is turning into an expanding gas. That gas is pushed out of the back of the rocket and pushes the rocket up, so that chemical energy actually gets converted into kinetic energy. And I'll note that it's both kinetic energy that's stored in the motion of the rocket and remaining fuel and kinetic energy that's stored in the motion of the exhaust, right? So this is the total kinetic energy of the system, and I could do a more detailed accounting, but it gets kind of confusing to keep track of what's the kinetic energy of the fuel and what's the kinetic energy of the exhaust. Finally, some of that kinetic energy as the rocket travels up, that kinetic energy that the rocket has gets changed into potential energy. Right? If the rocket has, say, I gave the rocket some initial kick and gave it some velocity up, that initial kick would be kinetic energy that would eventually get transformed into potential energy when it was higher in the air. And finally, in keyframe 4-3, that potential energy would get transformed back into kinetic energy, right? So there'd be a flow back and forth between kinetic energy and potential energy in this system. Finally, you'll notice that in both this keyframe and in this keyframe, the rocket is traveling through the air. And to that extent, it's got some velocity, it's experiencing drag. So this kinetic energy can also be lost to the rest of the universe through drag, right? So we have here, if we think about this from sort of forces perspective, the chemical energy is increasing the kinetic energy of the system through the interaction that we're calling thrust. The kinetic energy is getting transformed into potential energy and vice versa through the gravitational lift. This has to do with gravity either increasing or decreasing the kinetic energy of the system. And finally, the loss of kinetic energy to the rest of the universe is through the drag interaction. And since drag is a dissipative force, it really doesn't make sense to think about energy being stored in that interaction. Rather, it's energy that is lost to the motion of a whole bunch of particles that can't actually be recovered. One sort of note that I'll make here is that there's sort of some implied thermodynamics ideas in here. That is, you can turn chemical energy into kinetic energy. It's a whole lot harder to turn that kinetic energy back into chemical energy. By the same token, you can turn kinetic energy into thermal energy that's stored in the motion of all these particles, but it's kind of hard to get all those particles to line back up and push the rocket back to give you the kinetic energy back. Whereas this potential energy that's stored in the gravitational interaction actually can, you can have kinetic energy that's transformed into that, that then gets transformed back into kinetic energy. And this has to do with the idea that this is a conservative interaction, whereas this is what we'd call a dissipative or a non-conservative interaction.